Good morning and welcome to worship on this first Sunday in Lent. Each Sunday morning at 8:30 and 10:30 a.m., we have in-person services of Holy Communion. Each Wednesday at 12:10 p.m., we also have a spoken service of Holy Communion, and then at 7 p.m., we have Lenten Vespers. Please join us for these worship opportunities. Now, let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship during the prelude. Please join in the order for confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. God of steadfast love, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We have wandered from your ways. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to forgive those who have sinned against us. Have mercy on us, create in us new hearts, and restore to us the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O Lord God, you led your ancient people through the wilderness and brought them to the promised land. Guide us now so that, following your Son, we may walk safely through the wilderness of this world toward the life you alone can give. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 4th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. What comes to mind when you hear the word temptation? Now, before you start getting nervous, that's simply a rhetorical question. You will not be asked to make or submit a written list or go through confession again this morning. This is merely an exercise in silent personal reflection. What comes to mind when you hear the word temptation? On the one hand, the word temptation may bring to mind issues associated with out-of-control behavior or moral transgressions or self-indulgence or insensitive treatment of others for personal gain or pleasure. On the other, more humorous hand, we may think of Oscar Wilde, the witty Irish poet and playwright, who said that he could resist everything except temptation. In a similar vein, the American stage and film star, actress, and playwright Mae West famously quipped, "I never give in to temptation unless I can't resist it." Temptation, or testing, is at the heart of our gospel reading today, as it is every year on the first Sunday in Lent, when we find Jesus of Nazareth still wet from his baptism in the River Jordan on a 40-day vision quest in the desolate and harsh wilderness. A tired and hungry Jesus is tempted to pursue personal contentment, to overcome hunger with a little bread, to achieve the satisfaction of powerful leadership, and to demonstrate trust in God with a dramatic stunt at the temple in Jerusalem. Just like the people of Israel who wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, Jesus is shown learning what it means to be chosen as he is put to the test those 40 days. Will he choose power, fame, and influence? Will he be swayed to be someone he is not, putting himself at the center of things, using his gifts for selfish ends and worldly ambition? Will he fall for the fairy tale that all of us hear over and over, that we are self-reliant, self-constructed, self-made, and above all, self-sufficient? Or will he keep his life in sync with God's vision and put his gifts to their proper use? Will he be the one God calls him to be? How will he respond to this test of identity? The parable of the temptation or testing of Jesus is, at its core, a story about ego. Ego, of course, is the Latin word for I, as in me, myself, and I, and has various shades of meaning, incorporating healthy self-esteem, self-respect, and self-regard on the one hand, but also harmful self-centeredness, pride, and conceit on the other. Another way of looking at the word ego is to think of it as one way we may attempt to ease God out. E-G-O. Ease God out. The gospel writer illustrates for us that Jesus, in his moment of crisis and testing, remains connected to his heavenly Father and does not ease God out. Jesus lives into what had been announced at his baptism, "You are my Son, the Beloved." As he deflects his adversary's taunts and temptations, He gives a clear and certain voice to his trust in God with a clear knowledge of who he is and whose he is. Each of us faces daily challenges to ease God out, to become someone or something we are not. These temptations are often subtle, appealing to our strengths rather than our weaknesses. Temptations don't usually show up as seductive serpents or as some diabolical character wearing a red suit with a pointy tail and carrying a pitchfork. Instead, temptations and tests come as coded, even subliminal messages that seek to undermine our identity and invite us to forget who and whose we are. So many commercials and advertisements suggest we are inadequate if we don't purchase this or that. So many headlines suggest a culture of scarcity, that there's not enough to go around. So many politicians spout fear and distrust, telling us that we have to look out for number one, be that individually or as a nation or race or religion or socioeconomic class or any of a variety of other categories. To paraphrase a quote attributed to the 19th century Scottish author and clergyman George MacDonald, the voices of evil tell us exactly what we most want to hear, that we belong only to ourselves. Jesus of Nazareth, of course, proclaimed a very different message in word and in deed. Grounded in a baptismal identity that empowered him, he would emerge from his wilderness experience to guide his followers in the countercultural way of love and sacrifice and care for others, instead of the worldly ways of self-centeredness, money, fame, and power. Jesus would travel a road that ended up in Jerusalem, the road of self-emptying love that got him nailed to a Roman executioner's cross. In life, in death, and in resurrection, he gave witness to God's trustworthiness and profound love for us, our need to keep God at the center of life, and God's promise to care for all God's children. We too are grounded in the baptismal promises of a loving God who gives us our identity. As we walk the way of the cross this Lenten season, may we see these 40 days as a gift of time in which we can grow in strength and discipleship to better resist the subtle ways the world tempts us to ease God out, the temptation to fill our lives with lesser things. We are not self-made. We are God-made and redeemed to live in community with God, the human family, and all of creation. May we see our sinfulness, our hunger, our frailties, our vulnerabilities. But may we also see our image as God's beloved children, broken, yet beautiful, forgiven, and restored by the free gift of grace in Christ Jesus our Lord. May we hold to what is good and what is true. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. We pray for the church. Sharpen its proclamation of the word so that your people learn to reject voices of deception and distraction. Strengthen all who are tempted to believe lies about themselves or others. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the earth and all its creatures. Help us protect wilderness places and all plant and animal species that call them home. Sustain farmers and all laborers who work the land and harvest the fruits of the earth's abundance. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the nations of the world, especially Ukraine. Awaken elected leaders and government officials to the needs of those who are oppressed, and grant them compassion to deal mercifully with immigrants and refugees who reside among us. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those in need. Hold tightly those who grow weary in their struggle with mental illness or with addiction. Ease the anxiety of those who live with dementia. Surround all who are sick with your abiding presence. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for this congregation. Teach us the stories of our faith by heart. As you accompanied our ancestors in their uncertainty, so guide us confidently into the future. Lord, in your mercy. We give thanks for those who have died. Gather them with all the saints into your eternal presence. Encourage us with the promise of the resurrection. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray together as we have been taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Thank you. Our service now begins, marked with the cross of Christ. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.